Thank you for those that cannot join us today. We were asked to record this Zoom. Just okay, people will still join us. So thank you, everyone, for joining us today. My name is Shimrit. I'm the director of the Chadera Yaron Partnership. I know that there are a few. I'm trying to see who is here, but some of you. This is the first time that you're joining us. First of all, if you can mute yourself, that would be amazing. Just a few words about who we are. We are part of the Jewish Agency, a partnership together global network. We promote, we develop, and we engage communities in Israel and worldwide. And we foster close friendships between nine Southeast US Jewish communities, the Jewish communities of the Czech Republic, and the Chadera Yaron region. Again, for those of you who are not familiar, our region is the city of Chadera, Pardes Hanna Karkur Local Council, Menashe Regional Council, and Alona Regional Council. And we run a variety of programs from young ages of elementary school, the youth leadership, the young adults, cultural exchanges, and all kind of activities that build relationships between our communities. Since October 7, our region has taken many evacuees from the south and the north who have integrated into our community life. The partnership has played an active role in easing their transition. We organize activities with the youth, Shabbat greetings, holidays. We gave them all kinds of gifts, anything that can help them. And although our region is considered a safe place, the situation in Israel also affects our community here. I can tell you personally, and most of you know, my husband is in reserve, my daughter is in the artillery unit, so it's something that affects all of us. And a lot has been said about the wars that the people of the South experience. It's something that we cannot even imagine, and more stories emerge every day. For example, today, I don't know if some of you heard or saw. We just saw in the news a Hirsch a video of the kidnap of Hirsch and a few others. And it's just terrible. But yes, let's say that less attention is given these days to more than 60,000 residents of the north that have been evacuated from their homes for many, many months. And their voices deserve our attention and support as well. The situation in the north has been deteriorating, and it's causing immense hardships for the communities living there. Their stories, struggles, and resilience must be heard and acknowledged. And today we invited Mirav and Rui Gutman. I'm sorry, but I feel like I'm hearing myself. I don't know why, but. Again, thank you. So Mirav and Rui Gutman are here with us. They're both from the north. We invited them to share their personal story and through them, hear the voices of the residents of the north. What is special about their story is the actions and the initiatives being taken for the future of the north and the reconstruction of the communities. And if you have any questions for them after the presentation or throughout the presentation, please feel free to ask through chat. You can either send it to me or to Eitan, and they will be happy to answer. So to introduce them, as I said, with us today, and I hope I'll be able to say it correctly, Professor Mirav Aharon-Gutman, an urban sociologist, a faculty member in the Faculty of Architecture and Town Planning at the Technion, a research fellow at Shmuel Neumann Institution for Policy, the academic chair of the Technion Social Hub, and the associate professor Roy Gutman, Department of Animal Sciences, Faculty of Sciences and Technology at Tel Chai College, and head of the Laboratory of Integrative Physiology, the Department of Nutrition and Natural Products at Migal Galil Research Institute. So I hope I said it correctly. And Merav and Roi, again, thank you for joining us. And please, the stage is yours.
Thank you, Shimrit, for this opportunity. We appreciate that a lot. We appreciate the stage that you gave us to really bring the situation in the north into people's knowledge and mind and hearts. It's very difficult. Even inside Israel, people are not fully aware for the difficulties here and the harsh situation. So we made the presentations for you. So, okay, now you see it. So as Shimrit said, my name is Meirav Aaron Gutman. I'm a faculty member at the Technion. I'm a PI of a lab that use a data-driven policy simulator through 3D models of city, computational models of cities. And since the war began, I established a research group in Shmuel Nehrman Institution in the Technion. And the name of the group is Habaita, Home. And we decided to focus ourselves on the situation in the north. And in the same time, I joined the Lobby 1701, that is a group of different, very diverse groups of Israeli society that came together to stand and advocate our situation in the north. And the combination between the two, the fact that I'm part of NGOs working in time of war, and my other hat as a research that conducted real-time research, is I think is what brings maybe our conversation today to be interesting. So this is the situation in Israel in one map, and everybody are speaking about the situation in the north since October 7th, but today we want to put the north in the center. This is Kiryat Shmona. Let's take a few seconds.
Saturday night in the backseat, there was a gun. Words were fast, shotgun blast, trouble times had come.
So when I saw this video, I thought about this beautiful song of Bruce Springsteen, which is my favorite singer. And I thought that this is what happened to my hometown. So I was born and raised in Kiryat Shmona, which is a small town, development town, very near the border in Lebanon. And I'm the youngest daughter in family of six, brother and sister. My parents came from Iraq and Iran in the early 50s. And we live in Kiryat Shmona till I was 12 years old. 13 years ago, we moved back to live and to act in the Galilee. So you see here our family. We had a bar mitzvah year this year. So this is like the beautiful bar mitzvah photo. Roi, maybe you want to say something to introduce yourself. Roi, you are muted.
I thought that I would introduce myself later.
Let's say, were you born?
I was born in the Galilee. I was born in Tzfat. Then I moved to Korazim. I will explain later. And this picture, and the picture was taken in Korazim, in Old Korazim, in the old synagogue of Old Korazim. So it is very close to the place that I was not born, but raised.
Thank you, Roy. So we originally from the Galilee, we came back 13 years ago to the Galilee to be part of this place and community. We are parents for three children, and maybe we will say how the situation affected our life. So 4 days after October 7th, our daughter Romy supposed to go to her big trip in South America after she finished her duty in the army. And she decided to cancel her trip and to go to the army again. So you can see a very dear picture for me on the left, that she took the mochila, the bag that she bought, and everything that she organized for the tour and go to the army. And on the right, you can see a part of her activity in the first months of the war. Our son Jonathan became 18, and he was also go to the army. The picture on the left is the last day that he was a civilians, and you can see the exciting mom and the happy boy. And on the right, you can see Alon, which is the bar mitzvah boy, making an activity as part of his bar mitzvah mission, in front of playing a flute in front of people in the kindergarten in Rosh Pina. So this is us as a family. Two-thirds of my kids are in the army, and one was heavily affected in mostly by or because education, but we will touch it again. So this is me. We spoke about it later. I want to say something about the situation in the north before October 7th. Before October 7th, our area is living a huge paradox. From one hand, we are living in the most beautiful place in Israel. We have the mountains, we have rivers, we have the Sea of Galilee, and we are very happy to live here in terms of quality of life. But at the same time, our area is poor in education, is poor in employment opportunities, is poor in services, is very poor in terms of health services, and other problems that we have. And you can see here in the map that we are divided to many municipalities. This fact creates a situation in which mayors fight each other, compete each other, and don't cooperate enough. And this is, it brings us to be in this situation in a weak point. We enter this situation in a weak point. So a few dates and numbers. On October 16th, the IDF took a decision to evacuate a strip of 0 to 2 kilometers from the border. And 2 days later, the government took official decision and evacuate all the residents till 5 kilometers. That means that more than 70,000 people don't live in their homes for more than 8 months, and double of it are heavily affected. So if I'm going back to this picture, you can see the strip of 0 to 5 kilometers. That means that all the people that live here are evacuated and gain a lot of support from the governments. But at the same time, in this area, there are 8 kibbutzim that are still living in a war zone, and they are having almost no support, which is a very difficult situation. And I will say a few things about it later. We in the north and everybody in Israel are shocked from this situation, because in the past, when time was bad, they create a security strip inside Lebanon, and we never leave our houses, never. And now, as you see on the left, this strip is inside the territory of Israel, which is bad in so many terms. People don't live in their houses. The places are under huge attack. Houses are destroyed. There are fires everywhere. This trip, we feel like we're losing this trip. So I want to say something about, sorry, I will say something about the people that left their homes. All those people were moved to hotels and other shelters all over the country. So they didn't move as communities. And this is part of the problem. Kids don't go to school with their friends. Old people that was in a club or something, they don't have these services, etc., etc. But from my perspective, the situation of these eight kibbutzim that still living in a war zone is even worse. And I want to share with you two episodes, one for 2 weeks ago and one from last week. So let's see the
first one.
So this is a huge problem because they are moving and they are traveling to school using roads that Hezbollah can see and can attack. So this problem of kids that attacked on the way to school is a heavy problem here, and parents are fighting the state and struggling the state because they want to have solutions in terms of education within the kibbutzim, so the kids don't need to go around under the eyes of Hezbollah, which is a huge problem. And the second video I want to share with you is from Shavuot ceremony, which is beautiful, a holiday in kibbutzim. They have beautiful tradition of celebrating this unique holiday. And this is the effort. This is a video from Neot Mordechai. This is an effort to continue life, to have this ceremony, although they are living in a war zone. But have a look what happened in this. So this is how the attention or the trying to celebrate holiday and the day after the thing that you just that you see now is a mapping. A friend of mine mapped all the alerts that we experienced in the last months. You see, it's from May to June, and this is how the alerts look like. I have to say that Hezbollah use weapons that don't turn the alert on. So the things that we use, that we heard a lot and we run to a safe place, we don't have it anymore in Israel. Now you can like see the bombing and then you will hear the alert, which is extremely dangerous. And this is how it's look like. The video on the right is almost every day. This is the situation now in the north. Okay, the day after the attacks on Shavuot evening, fires started in our area. You have to understand, they live in the Middle East. It's very hot here. It's uniquely hot, more hot than every other summer. So when there is bombs, there are fires, and the fire are all over. There were two times here that we've been in Rosh Pina, which is not in the front line, okay? And in Rosh Pina, we felt and we saw the fire everywhere, and it was kind of very, very scary. This is a video that we took from Birya, Yar Birya, if you know the place. It's above Chatzor HaGlilit, between Tzfat and Chatzor HaGlilit. And this is how we live here in the last weeks. Okay. So all this situation, what is implication for? And now I will say a few things on different issues. First, agriculture. Here you see in the picture a chicken coop that was on fire in Aviv. This is like from few days ago. I didn't want to share all the awful picture of dead chickens with you, but the things that annoy me the most is that the Ministry of Agriculture didn't give any instruction to the people that own those chicken coops, and people put their life on dangerous to collect the eggs and to bring eggs to the market in Israel, and nobody give them instruction or help them. Same problem in the plantation, that there are no people to take the fruit from the trees. The implication of education is awful. There are three main problems, as I see it, for three different populations. For the people that evacuated from their home and live in the hotels, etc., there is a big numbers of dropping from school, dropping out of school, because people in teenager live in different rooms from their parents. So the parents are lost control on their schedule. They early all night, they sleep all day, and they don't want to go to other schools, that they don't know anybody there. So this is a huge problem. I will show a statistic later. The people that still there in the eight kibbutzim, the embedded strip, as I call it, are learning under fire, as you see. And our kid, for example, and all the people that live in our area are learning only 3 hours a day and only 4 days a week. So our kid is 13 years old, he learn 12 hours a week, which is awful situation. And for him too, all the schedule and all the order of life change. Another thing that we saw is a massive destruction. A lot, hundreds of houses in Metula, in Kiryat Shmona, all over the north, in Margaliot, in Kibbutz Manara, are destroyed, and there is a huge damage to the town and settlements. So now, Roy, if you want to say a few things about the implication for research and higher education, I will be happy.
Thank you, Mirav. Can you see my presentation?
Yes.
Okay, just a second. Okay, so my name is Roy. I'm also Mirav's husband. And I will just in 5 or 6 slides try to just a second. Opa. I will try to explain how hard is it to continue and conduct high cutting edge research in the Galilee. And I hope that I can convince you that although we can do that during wartime, it is something that we cannot do it for a very long time. So first, I want just to tell you a little bit about myself. I was born in Tzfat. Then I moved to Korazim. I'm a parent to two. Both of my parents came from Argentina to Israel. They were very passionate about being a Zionist in Israel and decided to even build a new settlement. And indeed, at the age of 12 years, we moved to Korazim, a settlement that they actually were the they built it up. And I went to high school here at Hatzor HaGlilit. And during my high school, I did a science project that then it was a very young research institute, Neid Meigal, and I'm pointing this out because now today I'm actually own a lab or running a research lab at that research institute. And my military service, I was a captain at the armed forces in the Israeli army, and I actually spent 4 years in the Golan Heights and in the Lebanon border. So I think that I have a good perspective of what it means to live in the Galilee. Then I did all my degrees, bachelor, master, PhD in animal physiology in Tel Aviv University. Then Merav and I went to Columbia University and did a postdoc fellowship. We came back and I did another postdoc fellowship at the Hebrew University. And 13 years ago, I was given an offer to actually fulfill a dream of mine, which was to live in the Galilee and be a scientist at the Galilee. And this was, and I could do so, because I received an offer from Tel Chai College, who is placed here, just between Kiryat Shmona and Metula, and Meigal Research Institute, who is placed at Kiryat Shmona, to become an animal physiologist. And as during the last 14 years, I'm the head of the Laboratory of Integrative Physiology. Just a few words about what I'm studying. So I'm studying metabolism and the novel anti-metabolic syndrome food additive. I also study alternative protein and eatable insects. I also study energy homeostasis in cows and milk production in cows. And I'm very fond of circadian regulation, longevity, and obesity studies. And I was doing so for the last 14 years until the war started. And I placed this picture because 3 weeks before the war started, we went, my lab and I, we went on a lab trip to a Katzrin winery. And we took that photo, and actually that was the last time that all of us met together. The first thing that happened once the war started is that two members of my lab were recruited for a reserve service. And when they finished their reserve service, they were evacuated. And the other lab members, Kathleen, Stav, Kfir, and Ruben, were evacuated from the Northern Galilee. All of the people in the picture except me were living in Kiryat Shmona before the war. And now all of them are evacuated. So Kathleen, who gave birth a few weeks ago, was evacuated to Tiberias, and she had to move from several places. And Sar also is living in a hotel for the last 9 months. Sav is living here for the last 9 months, and Reuven is living here, while Kfir and Matan are living or went back to live in their parents' house. And I'm living in Rosh Pina, so I'm the only lab member that is still living in his home. The second thing that happened is that we realized that we needed to find new places to conduct research. And I had an immediate feeling or hunch that it will take months or even more than a year. I didn't realize that it may take years, but now I think that it could take even years. And we decided to find new places. So with the help of many friends, we relocated. We relocated our lab equipment to Katzrin, to a lab of a friend of mine who is a faculty member at Tzfat, at the Bar-Ilan Faculty of Medicine, and to a lab of a colleague of mine in a research institute near Tivon. And everything was done in a week or two. And the other problematic thing is that we need to find places that the lab members can commute to. So if we have a lab member that is living in Tiberia, then he or she, at this case, were going to Katzrin or to Neve Yar to conduct their science, their research project. And Reuven is commuting from Maalot to Tzfat to do his master project. And we did everything ourselves. So I took my car, this is my Jeep, and I put as many things that I could place in and just move back and forth and took equipment, facilities, small things and large things. And we established a new lab in a teaching classroom at Katzrin. And that is the new Gutmann lab for the last 9 months. So what is the current situation and the challenges? So regarding teaching, and I'm also a teacher at the Tel Chai College. So we teach by Zoom, and We are very concerned about registration for the next academic year. We actually know that we will not be able to teach at the high college in the starting academic year this October. And we're trying to think of ways that we can still attract students to learn in a college that is completely virtual. We will become a university in the coming years, but as for now, we are a virtual college. Regarding research, actually, we're not doing that bad. So we are being able to do 90% of the potential. And there are some advantages. For example, I have more time to summarize data and publish many articles, but there are many challenges. It is very difficult to recruit new graduate students and research assistants because it is very hard to find or to rent an apartment now in the Galilee because everyone was evacuated from the northern part of the Galilee to the southern part of Galilee. And it is very hard to do remote management of new graduate students that are not very experienced. And there's also starting, we know, and we know that there are now academic boycotts against research scholars from Israel. So what about the future? I'm super optimistic. We know that we are resilient, but not forever, and time works against us. As long as the war will be longer and longer, it will be very hard to build things together and to restore everything that was destroyed. And the huge problem will be manpower, manpower, and manpower. People will not be very reluctant to leave, to go back and live in the Galilee. People with families, young children, with young children will consider twice and three times whether to go back and live in the Galilee. Young students, young people will maybe prefer to start their studies in other places, and that will make recruiting new students and research assistants very hard. And although the government may decide to help and to promote the region, there will be so many other problems also at the southern part of Israel, and also many other economic problems that I'm not sure that they will have the resource to help us, even if we'll decide to give an extra push to the Galilee. So,
thank you, Raiki.
That is the situation now in the Galilee regarding research.
Thank you. Okay, so regarding this was an intro about what's going on here and what the implication of the situation on the civilians issues. And now for research, we conduct two research. One, we call it home, a milestone in the formulation of policy for the return of residents to their home after fighting. There are QR here, you can screen it. It's in Hebrew, but we have an English abstract. So you can see it. And the other thing that we did, we conduct a survey among the people that evacuated from their home. And I want to share with you some of our findings. First, on the right, you can see the locations of people that answer us before, where they lived before the war. And on the left side, you can see where they are now. And I think this the differences between those maps telling the whole story. I want to say something very interesting. In Israeli society, we are very divided, the kibbutzim and the Ayarot Pituach, the Mizrahis, the Ashkenazis, etc., etc. What's unique in this situation and in our survey that in the first time research come to this area and see all the geographical unit as one sociological unit, and we ask them the same questionnaire. And they all different, very divided groups in the Israeli society say the same very interesting thing. They said first that they feel that they live in the periphery. For example, you can see that they mark that they suffer from poor employment opportunities, but at the same time, everybody said that they feel lucky, that they feel that they live in beautiful places and they want to still live there in the day after the war. So you can see that we have, I call it the report, a whirlwind. We have a wind, we have a spirit of loving this area, although we really aware that we don't have the same opportunity as the center of the country. And again, regarding education, which I see the most difficult problem, so you can see the outcome. You can see that 53% of the people that answer us say that the kids are in new schools in the center of the country. 27% go to the schools that open in the hotel. A fifth of the children do not go to school, which is a lot, and the situation now is worse. And 50% are still registered in their original schools. From my perspective as a sociologist, I see that the things that push, you know, in immigration theory, we speak about push and pull, why people immigrate. So education will be the push for people to leave our area, because you can see here in the center of the country, you have beautiful schools and very strong education system, and the things that we don't see in our places here. If we want to see a data regarding work, we see that the picture is not so clear as education. We see that a part of the people are unemployed, part of the people unemployed and gain support from the state, part of the people work in new places, part of the people work from distance. So we see different patterns of how people deals in terms of work. Here we ask, what will bring you back? What will bring you with motivation to go back? And we can see that people really care about health and employment. This is the two main things that they share with us that they concern about. We ask about the relationship within the family and outside the family. And here too, it was very interesting. Part of the people say that now the family is much more together and much more strong. And part of the people said they are suffering, they're having a bad time in terms of a relationship because they are all living in hotel, and it's like it's very dense and very, very stressful. We can see that people took medicines more and smoke more than usual, or in parallel to the war. We asked them, what will be your condition to return to live? And people said that they do expect different solution. They want a protection. They want to see the army, that the army will be there for them, etc. It is important to say, maybe I should say it in the beginning, that I think that Israel society is not very concerned about rockets and bomb and alert. The traumatic component in this war is the fact that Hamas entered the state of Israel and entered the settlements, the kibbutzim, Ofakim, etc., and did what it did. So everybody here concerned about the fact that a lot of people in one night will come into Israel. This is the main concern, and people want to see things that obstacles and the soldiers on the borders. In the first report that we wrote, we spoke about the opportunities that we have in terms of Build Back Better. I'm coming from the Faculty of Architecture and Town Planning, and we, if we want to join Roi and to be optimistic, I will say that war is an opportunity to build back better, to rebuild the infrastructure, rebuild the houses, rebuild the poor neighborhoods in Kiryat Shmona, Shlomi, as well as in Manara and other places in the north. So we will stop here and we will be more than happy to answer your questions or to have your comments. Maybe we really concentrate on this on our situation as people living here, but and we are not specialists in terms of army and geopolitical situation here, but the situation is very, very, very complicated, and the question whether will be a war or not will be a war, it's a huge stress that we feel, and we are within this dilemma and within this lose-lose situation, but we are not an expert for the situation, so I don't know that we can give you an answer for that.
Thank you. I see that there was a question on the chat. Can you talk more about the grassroots group, who it is, what are they doing?
I don't sure that I understand the question. What are the grassroots?
Jenna?
Who else?
Sam, you're muted.
The organization has a number, like I can't remember what it is, but they started like an encampment in the middle of the Galil.
Okay, can you help me here? Can you explain that, please?
יש להם איזשהו מספר.
כן, 17.
והם עשו קמפ בתוך הגליל.
רואי, אתה על מיוט.
I'm on mute?
No, רואי.
Now I'm not, I wasn't on mute.
Go ahead, try. Sorry, Rui, try unmuting again. I muted you by accident.
Should I?
No, Rory, you're on mute.
Okay. Sorry, now I'm on mute. So you are referring to the organization named 1701?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So the name comes from a UN resolution named 1701. That was a resolution by the UN, I cannot remember when, I think maybe 20 years ago.
Ended the second Lebanon War, 2006.
Mm-hmm. So in 2006, there was a resolution by the UN that stating that actually Hezbollah is forbidden of showing or any armed forces southern to the Litani. Litani is a river. Inside Lebanon, and the idea was that there will be a zone of several kilometers, maybe five, maybe six, maybe seven, that will be actually demilitarized, demilitarized by, so Hezbollah cannot be there. So the only forces in that zone could be the Lebanon's army, which actually doesn't do anything. And obviously, the UN forces that are, I don't know. I don't know what to say. So that is, the name comes from that resolution.
The residents here want to emphasize the fact that we don't want war from one perspective, but from the other perspective, when was a paper that was signed, nobody, nobody forced it.
Enforce it.
So the mandate of the UN, UNIFIL actually, United Nations Force of Lebanon, their mandate was to enforce that resolution and prevent from Hezbollah to have any forces several kilometers from the Israeli northern border.
Okay, so thank you, Ricky.
V'mihem, v'maim osim.
So what they do is they create awareness.
Mm-hmm.
So what they do is they count what is going on.
Mm-hmm.
They talk to the media because mm-hmm. The Israeli media is very focused on what is happening in the southern border of Israel, which mm-hmm. is actually horrible, mm-hmm. and the condition with all the kidnapped, the more than 200 people that are still kidnapped, dead mm-hmm. or alive, we don't know. So that is the main focus of the Israeli media. And what is happening in the northern part of Israel is being left aside. So the goal of that organization is to create awareness. They don't want to provoke a mm-hmm. war, but they want to create awareness, and they want to emphasize the fact that the UN already declared that there should not be any armed forces in mm-hmm. of several kilometers from the Israeli border. So.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Shimrit, you have more question from G, Liz, Eric.
Oh. Sorry, I didn't think. Yes, Bill.
Thank you. I think what you had to share was fascinating and profound. And I can't thank you enough. But Professor Gutmann, could you just share a little bit more about your optimism? Oh, Professor Roy Gutmann, I want to hear more about your optimism. Could you give some specifics that are on your mind besides your sparkling personality, which is making me smile?
Okay, so there are two options, to be an optimist or to be a pessimist. I think that I don't know whether I behave as an optimist or think as a pessimist, or think as a pessimist and behave as an optimist. But I think on one hand, we need to be prepared. So I'm trying to be prepared for anything bad that may have happened, that may happen in the future. But what other option I have than being an optimist? So if I will be a complete pessimist, so what I can do with that pessimism? So where to go, what to do? So,
thank you. That's great. Do you have a partnership city?
So Rosh Pina, Chatzor, which is a nearby town, and Sfat, which is the big town in the region, they have a partnership. Actually, my son and daughter were part of a delegation that the partnership is Palm Beach, Florida, Mela.
Yeah.
So we have a partnership at Palm Beach, Florida, but I don't know, maybe we can have more.
they're a good one. They're a good one. We are too, but hopefully they're taking good care of you in partnership with your needs.
I don't know. I'm not very involved. Melav is much more involved than I, so, but maybe.
Thank you, Roy. Liz, you have a question?
Yes. Yes. I wanted to understand a little more about why those, I think you said five kibbutzim were not evacuated, or did they choose not to evacuate? And also why you think the government is not supporting you as much as you'd like to see.
Thank you, Liz, for the question. There is a huge public discussion in Israel in the last months about this evacuation. As I said before, evacuation became an issue for itself. Is it the right one or not? Maybe we should stay, etc., etc. And till today, there are a lot of interesting and sad phenomena. For example, old people that leave their houses and travel between hotels, decided to go back home, no matter what happened. We see a very sad phenomena that old people that leave their home died more. Now I know that people from Tel Chai College conduct research about it and try to collect the data. But old people died faster if you see the data parallel to the last year, because the moment they leave their homes, they have no reason or no lost reason to live. So I don't see, and I'm not sure this is the right thing to do, to evacuate the other kibbutzim. There is a thesis going on here that every place that we evacuated, Hezbollah target more and destroy houses. I'm not sure about this. I think that the things in Israel at the moment, and actually for us, it's much more difficult than the situation in terms of the relationship with Hezbollah, is our government, because many people in Israel don't trust this government, and we see it as it's something that very affected our resilience. We feel very, very bad about it. We don't. One of the problems of this government that we feel that there is no decision taken. So even the evacuation, it wasn't, you know, decision that will talk. In the first day of October 7th, the people in the north saw the things live on TV, on through the social media, and they didn't wait for anybody. They know from history, they know the things that happened in Ma'alot, in Tzfat, in Kiryat Shmona, in Yehuda Halevi, Shar Yeshuv. So they flee from their houses in the same Shabbat or in Sunday morning. So I think that in this issue, as in others, the government is after the pressure from the public, and we don't see a leadership. For example, as I said, for me, the things with the chicken coop, I can't believe that this is the situation, that the Ministry for Agriculture don't come to the people and say to them, okay, let's do this or that. This is our policy. And people put their life on risk and go to collect these eggs. And we feel like we have no parents. There is no somebody that in charge and lead us.
No leadership. Thank you. Thank you for explaining that. I'm sorry.
Any question? Thank you both for sharing such important information with all of us here. We really feel everything you're going through. My question is for Ra'i. You talked about manpower issues. Obviously, a lot of those are long-term. Are there short-term options? Are you partnering, or do you have any communication with people who might be willing to come for 2 weeks? There are a lot of programs in Israel bringing volunteers for shorter periods of time. Is that an option for the help you need? And if so, how can people who might be interested do that?
So short-term help is not something very practical. So if you conduct science, you need people that or have experience and they have skills and tools, analytic tools or computational tools that they can do some work, or that are willing to come for a year, 2 years to do a master degree, a PhD degree, a postdoctoral fellowship, and then they can be of great help. So it's not something that the short-term student exchange program or something like that can make a change. What can be of some help is, for example, in my lab and in many labs in biology, many things are computational. So you can do it remotely. You can analyze data from Africa or from Antarctica or from Montana, okay? So that is something, and I offer that to our college board, maybe to find a way to recruit fellows, students, student exchange program that they not need to actually be in the galley. They can analyze data, they can edit papers, they can do some work even remotely. And I must say that it was an idea that I gave people. I cannot say that it is something that is going on now. Maybe there is an option. Maybe people are thinking of that. But as 8 months pass, I think that we could start with that program 7 months ago. So that is something that can be done as from tomorrow.
Maybe as a sociologist, I can say that before the war, we have a problem of middle class here in the north. There is not enough middle class here. So a lot of people from the layers in the society that Roy need in his lab are not living here. And this is a huge problem. And maybe something more we have even before the war, and now it's a huge crisis. We have no teachers. We have no teachers for math. We have no teacher for English. We have nothing. Maybe in this issue, you can contribute or do something in helping us to train people to teach English, to teach things. We have a lack in teachers. Severe lack in teachers. And maybe something more about our region. It became very, very, very religious. In the last municipal election, there was elected a mayor in Tzfat, which is from Shas party. And this is like the last mile of bringing Tzfat to be fully ultra-Orthodox. And the same happened in Tveria, which back in the 70s and 80s, where our urban area, the place that we can consume services, the places where the middle class sit, and now we have nothing from this. And the first time that we have a really place for us for services is Carmiel. So the situation here is very, very complicated.
So there's so much to continue to talk about. I'm sure that if we continue even one more hour, there will be more questions and more information. Of course, if you have other questions, it's been an hour, a very interesting one. If you want me to send or in the other questions, or I can send you all the links to their research, to their links to their websites, whatever it is that you want, we can definitely do that. And feel free to here, Roy is also sending his email. Thank you, Roy. And as I said in the beginning, this is a very important voice that we need to bring the voices of the communities in the north. It's again, like I said, it's not heard enough. They need our continuous support and attention. And we need to understand the reality that they're facing daily, their struggles, and we need to be inspired also by their resilience and their determination to come back home. As Marav said, a lot of them do want to come back home. So thank you again for participating today and dedicating your time to this important issue. Thank you, and take care, everyone.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.